Church, and we are excited to have you, and we're excited to have the Steve Pettit ministry team with us. And let's give him a hand. We're so thankful that they're here. How many of you are familiar with Steve Pettit from the past? Many in our church. He's been here before. We were talking before this afternoon a little bit about just the history, and I know him as far back as when I was like 10 years old, I'm pretty sure. I'm young, so that doesn't age him too much, I think. It goes way back. He was an evangelist. Many of you know him as the president of Bob Jones University for several years, and now he is back to traveling, but in a new format with this music team. And so we're excited to have him. A couple things, just wanted to say that afterwards we're going to offer some coffee and some snacks, and would love a chance to get to talk to you and hang out in fellowship. If you are new to Lighthouse, I would love a chance to get to meet you, both Matt and I. And so we'll be in the back there around the coffee table, and be sure to stop by and see us after everything is over. I think that's all I have to say, so I'm going to turn it on over to Dr. Steve Pettit.
All right. Thank you, Pastor, so much. Thank you. Well, Pastor, I'm so glad you started the service, because I live, you have muscle memory. Whatever you have in your memory, you have muscles for it. And I always start services at 7 o'clock, so I was thinking, wow, this is a great crowd, 30 minutes before the event starts. So I'm glad we started right on time. Thank you tonight. Good to see you. We're so delighted to be out tonight. This is a concert of bluegrass gospel and traditional bluegrass songs. And I don't know if you know much about bluegrass music, but your life could be falling apart, but it's still happy music. And so we're going to have a wonderful time tonight. So I want you to know that that laughter and clapping is approved and it's appropriate and it's appreciated, all right? So if you don't clap, then we're going to look at you like we're mad, okay? So please enjoy it. Tonight we're going to sing about the Lord, because we want to lift his name up and exalt him, and we'll be testifying, and then we'll have a message, and so it'll just be a wonderful evening. It's Friday night. There's nowhere to go, and it's too cold outside anyway. So we're so glad that you're here. We want to begin tonight with lifting up the name of the Lord as we sing the song, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. name up tonight and glorify our God. And one of the most wonderful things is that the Lord constantly tells us who he is. And David tells us in Psalm 23 that the Lord is our shepherd. You know, everybody needs a shepherd. They need somebody to guide them. They need somebody to guard them. They need somebody to feed them. They need somebody to lead them. And as we follow the great shepherd, we discover that all of our wants are found in him, and therefore we shall not want. Listen carefully as Brindley sings this next tune entitled, I Shall Not Want. Thank you so very, very much. Well, when the Lord told his people to go up to the city of Jerusalem for their festivals, for their big feasts, Passover, Pentecost, Tabernacles, he told them to go up, and he said, when you come up, he said, come up with a happy face. He tells his people to rejoice. And he says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, so you don't forget it, rejoice. And for God's people, we should be constantly rejoicing in who he is, what he has done, his power, his control over our lives. And we want to do a wonderful song that is simply entitled, Rejoice.
Your voice.
Ministry is to travel and to really spread the gospel. That really is our heartbeat through both song and sermon, through music and through message, telling people about Jesus Christ, who is able to save you. and to forgive you and to make you his child. If you're here tonight as a guest or a visitor or whether a church member, our hope and our prayer is that every one of you, when you leave this building tonight, will know in your heart that you are a child of God, that Christ is living inside of you, and that he is your hope. The next song we're going to do is the title of our newest recording that will be released in just about 3 weeks now. On April 16th, it will be released on Spotify. It's available to be purchased early if you're interested in pre-ordering the CD recording. And it's a really an incredible recording that was done in Nashville, Tennessee. Our group went in. We worked with a gentleman as our producer, Mr. Andy Lefwich, who played the fiddle for a gentleman named Ricky Skaggs for 15 years. And he said, we're going to elevate you a little bit. And he said, I'm going to bring in some of my friends who are going to play along with us. And he happened to bring in 4 Grammy recipients to play with us. So it is an incredible recording. And the title song that we did is this song that we'd like to do tonight. It was written by this young man here, Carson Aaron. And it's God's, it's really a child of God crying out to the Lord to bring his heart back into alignment with the Lord. The song says our hearts are prone to wander and we feel it. And so to stay right with the Lord is not hard, it's impossible without God's grace in your life. Listen as we do the song, Unite My Heart.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, we'd like to play some traditional bluegrass tunes for you. And as we get ready to do that, let me introduce those that are up here on the stage that are playing. Our banjo player here is from the state of North Carolina. Would you please welcome Mr. Jack Ritter? And Jack started playing the banjo when he was 13 years old, but he also played football. He played small college football down in Virginia and South Carolina. And so we're so glad to have a linebacker on our team here with us. And then from the state of Texas, singing soprano, would you please welcome Miss Kirsten Curling. So glad to have Kirsten with us. And these ladies have beautiful voices. And this is Miss Brinley Tekelly, who is from the state of Michigan. So glad to have Brinley singing. And she sings the alto part. And then our bass player, we actually flew her in today. Our normal bass player is on vacation. The rest of us have to work for a living, but he's on vacation. And so we brought in this young lady, and she is going to be traveling with us this fall. And she is graduating in just a couple of weeks from Bob Jones University in Greenville, South Carolina. And she is also the sister of our banjo player. Would you welcome Hallie Ritter from North Carolina? And then playing our fiddle from the state of Idaho, Miss Savannah Lacey. So glad to have Savannah with us. And Savannah started playing the violin when she was 3 years old. And then she went to Bob Jones University to study violin performance. She became the first chair, first violin concert master in the symphony. And then the Lord delivered her. And she went from playing classical to playing grassical. And we are so thrilled to have that girl playing the fiddle for us. And then our guitar player and singer and songwriter for many of our songs is Mr. Carson Aaron from the state of Arkansas. So glad to have Carson with us. And he started playing bluegrass music in his dad's band when he was 5 years old. And so it's come pretty naturally to him. But what also is coming very naturally is that this young man here decided that he loved this young lady here and asked her for her hand in marriage back in Thanksgiving. Yeah. And they're getting married June 27th and coming back to travel as a married couple. And so we're so glad to have Mr. and Mrs. Carson Aaron. Wow, okay, thank you very much. That's kind of cool. All right. Well, we want to play some traditional bluegrass music for you. And I don't know how many of you have heard bluegrass before, all right? Many of you here.
Amen.
Well, bluegrass is an American style, made in America, amen? America, yeah, that's right. And it was put together by a guy named Bill Monroe, and he put together different instruments, and he created this sound that was incredibly unique. He took the three-finger banjo made famous by a man named Earl Scruggs. And he played the Earl Scruggs style of banjo that goes like this. There we go. All right. Thank you, Jack. Never know what Jack's going to do. It's kind of like Earl Scruggs. Anyway, and then he also had in his group, Mr. Bill Monroe. Bill Monroe had a guy in his group named Lester Flatt. You ever heard of Scruggs and Flatt? Flatt and Scruggs? And he played the most famous run in bluegrass called the G Run. There you go. There you go. You folks understand bluegrass tonight. So we're gonna do some tunes tonight. And this next one is a kind of a well-known bluegrass tune. It's about a guy who leaves home and he gets homesick and he wants to go back home. You know, it's the same old story. Everybody thinks that it's better out there and then they come back home. Anyway, this is called Lonesome Pine.
One, two, three. Smiles, soft and warm. Lonesome pine. in search of wealth, fortune, and fame. And late at night, when I'm alone and lonely, I still hear my dad call my name. Lonesome Pine, I can hear you calling, calling me back to my home.
Thank you very much. Well, when you learn to play bluegrass, you learn to play what we call fiddle tunes. You know, when you learn to play classical music, you learn Beethoven and Bach. And bluegrass, you learn Bill Monroe. This next tune is written by Bill Monroe, and it's a tune that's very well known called Salt Creek. We'd like to play it for you. And, of course, the key to playing bluegrass is you got to pick it clean and you got to pick it fast. Salt Creek. you. Well, we're going to ask this young lady that's playing our bass to come and sing the next song. It's a song that she wrote, and it was centered around a ministry we had when the number of these folks were students at Bob Jones University, and I was the president there. And we would go out and do ministry in various churches. Fact is, we came to this church while I was the president, and we flew up here, and we would fly in a plane, and then we'd get up in the clouds, and I always would tell the group, I said, you know, what's always interesting is that no matter what life is like on the ground, you can have clouds, you can have thunder, you can have gray skies, but the sun always shines above the clouds, always shines above the clouds. And sure enough, you could pull through dark clouds, and then you pop through, and it's all shining. And in life, we live a lot of times under the clouds. And the clouds take all kinds of shapes and forms, and they're rarely the same every single day. But the sun, that is God the sun, always shines above the clouds. And so this is a great song written by Hallie Ritter. Well, it seems like y'all are enjoying the music. You know, you want to make sure your crowd is enjoying what they're listening to, and it sounds like you're really enjoying it. So we're going to do one more traditional bluegrass tune before we continue on in our sacred set. And this song is a fiddle tune. That means no singing in it. It's just basically the instrumentalists playing and showing their skill and so forth, and sometimes showing off their skill. So this song was written by our banjo player, Jack Ritter. He wrote the tune without a title. And he came to us, told us about the song, and he told us he didn't have a title. And so he said, you know, but one day I opened up my case, and my banjo was sitting there, and I noticed there was a spider on my banjo. And we said, there's the title. The song is called Spider on the Banjo. And if you'll go to Spotify this summer, we're going to release it. As we recorded it, it was recorded with our bass player, our banjo player, Carson on the mandolin, and then two Grammy Award winners playing the fiddle and the guitar. You want to hear it this summer, Spider on the Banjo. The Lord tells us that his salvation that he gives to his people is something that we can be sure of. I'd like to ask you tonight, do you know that you're assured in your heart that you're going to spend eternity with the Lord? The Bible says that we can know that we have eternal life. We'd like to do this next song that's entitled, Be Assured. We're going to let Jack sing it for us as he gets his banjo tuned up. Yeah, tell a banjo joke. I used to think that the greatest problem in the world was global warming. It's actually banjo tuning, if you really want to know the truth to it. And That was supposed to be funny, apparently. Anyway, are we good to go there? Banjos are like deacons. They get out of tune real fast.
Okay, right. I'm ready. One, two, three. Thank you. I can't tell. I don't know about you guys, but we're having a good time. I think you can see that. I love playing with these folks. Thank you. Well, I'm going to take just a moment to share a word of my story. And basically, it goes all the way back to Arkansas, a place that is foreign to most of the world, including to the people in Arkansas, which is a conundrum I haven't figured out. But I grew up there, grew up playing music. There are entire towns in Arkansas built around bluegrass music. There's one town called Mountain View, Arkansas, where there's about 1,500 people. And on a normal Friday night, 1,000 of those people will be out in the town square playing bluegrass music in what they call pickin' parks. So that's how I grew up. I grew up playing music, and I would stand on a chair when I was 5 years old and play an upright bass for my dad's bluegrass band. I started playing guitar and other instruments when I was 12. I joined another bluegrass group that would play in Silver Dollar City and other places like that when I was 16. And then when I was 18 years old, I was trying to decide, what do I do with my life, as a lot of 18-year-olds ask. And my options were, no one in my family had gone to college, but I could go to college. And I had visited some schools, and I checked them out, but it just didn't really seem right for me at the time. And then I could also go into a trade like my dad, and thought about it, wasn't against it, but had the opportunity to sign a management contract to do country music. And so I looked at all the options, and I said, you know what, I think I'm going to try the country music thing. Had some connections with these guys through my mom's work in journalism. So signed a contract at 18 years old, and went to start trying to do this music career. Well, very quickly, I looked around, and I realized that everyone else in this, in that arena, in order to be successful, they had realized you have to sell out completely to it. And that doesn't necessarily mean, although it can mean, like, sell out as far as, like, losing your morality, losing your convictions. It just meant that it took up their whole life. They lived it, they ate it, they lived and they breathed, they woke up and thought about it, went to sleep, most of the time really late after playing a concert, thinking about it still. And so I looked at that and I started to ask myself, is it worth it? Is it worth my whole life to do this as a career? Well, by the Lord's grace, he began to open my eyes to the fact, really, that there's nothing else worth living for except the Lord Jesus Christ. That we can give our lives to so many other things. It could be any number of future goals. It could be career. It could be some kind of relationship. It could be our families. Good things, but out of order. It's just not how God intended it to be. So I called my management team. I said, guys, I don't think this is what I'm supposed to be doing right now. And they said, you know what? We could kind of sense that in you. They said, how about we do this? We'll give you all the money you've earned so far, and we'll let you out of the contract, but if you ever want to do country music again, give us a call. So at the end of that, I said, okay, Lord, if you never want me to do music again, I'll never do music again. As part of that contract, I'd had to write a lot of music. I was kind of burned out. And I had the opportunity to go work at a Christian camp in Montana. I landed in the airport in Denver for my connecting flight to Kalispell, looked at my email, and there was an email from NBC, and I had tried out for The Voice before. They said, we'd love for you to come on and continue the auditioning process for The Voice. And I looked at it, and just the craziest thing, I had no desire to do it anymore. The Lord had completely changed my desire. I got to the camp in Montana, and I started just searching the Bible and really fell in love again, as I had when I was saved when I was a kid, with the gospel and the worthiness of Jesus Christ, and that my whole life could be turned to him and just enraptured in him. He was so wonderful. And so then while I was there, I went into town. They didn't have cell service at the camp. Went into a coffee shop, looked at my phone, and I had an Instagram message from a guy named Steve Pettit. Yeah, the guy, that one. And Steve Pettit, I had, and the message said, hey, I met you at a school tour a few years ago. I'm the president of Bob Jones University. We have a little bluegrass group. And I don't know if you're interested in going to college, but we would love to have you come and be a part of it. So I said, okay, Lord, I guess I'm going to college. I got home from camp. 2 weeks later, I was in my first class. And interestingly enough, I came to this church. I don't know if how many of you remember a bluegrass group from Bob Jones came through here. Probably would have been my freshman year, like 2019. So I've met some of you before, but that was right after that experience. And so I went into Bob Jones, was there 4 years, graduated this last May with a degree in ministry and leadership. And that whole time, God was training me. He was using all the experiences of my past, and then the surrender that I had placed music under and giving it to God, and he was doing something great. So when we were starting to build this team, I started praying. I said, Lord, I would love to write music again. And I would love to do it for you. And with my Bible open, and a lot of times just praying, these songs came out of that. This next one's no different. It's a song that came out of, really, we had to get around the country somehow. We were praying for a van, for God to provide a van or something for us to travel in. And so this was a prayer that God would supply our needs. And I co-wrote it with a pastor friend of mine in Connecticut, Lance Schmidt. And this song really talks about something we all experience. I don't know, many of you may be facing difficult times, times where you have to wait on the Lord, times where you have to trust the Lord, and it seems like you can't see why you're still having to trust him. You just keep stepping forward, you keep doing the next right thing, but it sometimes gets difficult. Well, this song is kind of that, asking God, he sees every need, to supply the need. And in the chorus, there's one line that actually Lance wrote that I love. And it says, we have learned that the waiting is good. Kind of draws from the ideas of the old hymn, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. It's a song called So Sweet. Thank you.
Well, when you think about the testimony that Carson gave tonight about his own surrender to God, you realize that when you're a child of God, God is constantly working in your life. And God always works in you because God wants to do a work through you. Whatever God uses us to do for him, he starts in the heart. He wants the heart. And many of these young people could give the same similar testimony of a surrender to God. And then once you start growing in the Lord, you realize God's not finished with you. He's constantly working. And we'd like to do this song that Carson has written. I think it's a great tune entitled, He's Not Done.
Jack's tuning, so I might as well just tell you the quick story about this one, too. So we were staying with a family in Maryland. And this lady in ministry had been with her husband for years, and she had gone through this really difficult time, and she was telling the story, and she said, I didn't know how I was going to continue on, and a mentor came to me, and she said, I don't have anything else to tell you except that God's not done. Don't give up. He's not done. And she had a little sign in her kitchen that just said, He's not done. So I said, you know what? That'd be a pretty good song. So here's He's Not Done. One, two. Take courage, believer. The work isn't done. God loved us so much that he gave us his son to make us new. He's not done. All of the ways he's working around you every day, and sing his praise, 'cause he's not done. Every sun setting sees work that he's done. The joy of the morning, no storms and trials. You've carried your burden for many long miles, but you're not alone. He's not done. He calls to the weary, come find your rest. He takes up his towel and gives you his best. He knows your pain. He's not done. Savior, the strong cornerstone, and we don't lose heart, 'cause he's not done. And when he ascended, he said, tell of me, that I rescue sinners and I give them peace. So we march on, 'cause he's not done.
Like to do one more song before I take a few moments, it won't be long, but a few moments tonight from God's Word, and then we'll come back and close out this evening with one more song. And when we look at the scriptures from the beginning to the end of the Bible, God invites people to come to Him. And it starts where you come to Him for forgiveness, for eternal life, for salvation, for the gift of God. And then throughout the whole of our life, we keep coming back to Him, because really Christian living is simply living out in experience what happened to you the moment you became a child of God. If you think about it, what's the Christian life? Repent, believe, repent, believe, repent, believe. Well, you don't do that one time. Of course, you do that to become a Christian, but you do that the whole of your Christian life, where you turn from yourself and you turn back to the Lord. Where you constantly embrace the crucifixion of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus, our dying to ourself, our in having His resurrection power to live the Christian life. If you can get that in your mind, boy, that'll take you a long way as a Christian. And this next song is a beautiful old hymn that's powerful, that invites us to come to Him. It's called Come Ye Sinners.
Come ye sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore.
Well, can we have a word of prayer? Father, we thank you tonight for your goodness to us. We thank you for the gift of music that you've given to speak to our hearts. And Lord, I pray for just your blessing now on this time together for a few moments in Jesus' name. Amen. I'd like to read from the Gospel of John tonight, chapter 10 and verse 10. This is a verse that, if I could say, jumped out at me when I was a new Christian. Because I remember when I became a believer at the age of 19 years old, I really thought living the Christian life was, if I could put it this way, I wanted to go to heaven. But I didn't know how wonderful the Christian life could be. And I'm not saying easy, but wonderful. And this verse in John chapter 10, verse 10, sort of just jumped out at me. And Jesus said these words. He says, "The thief comes not but to steal and to kill and destroy." There he's speaking about the one who wants to rob our souls. That is Satan, the archenemy of God. This found in the very beginning of the Bible, who came in the Garden of Eden, tempted Adam and Eve. They sinned. Sin came into the world, and what followed sin was death and misery. And so that the thief came to kill, to steal, to destroy, to take from you what God intended for you to have. I want to tell you that the world is not what God intended. The world as it is today is a world of confusion, a world of sin, a world of death, a world of heartache, a world of heartbreak. That was never God's intention. But a thief came to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But listen to what Jesus said, why he said came. He said, "I am come," in contrast, "I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." Why is Jesus Christ come into this world? That you might have life, and life is the opposite of death. It is referring to life which is eternal, continuing to live on. It beats within the heart of every one of us the desire to live. Nobody wants to die. And when we hear when somebody dies, we're always shocked by it. Even if they've been sick for years, when we hear of death, it's an ultimate finality. It's like it's all over with. But every one of us sitting in this room knows within our heart and with our soul that there's something that's there that is eternal. And that life is going to spend eternity somewhere forever. And why did Jesus Christ come? He came that you might have eternal life. I ask you, do you want eternal life? Let me ask you a question. Do you want something better than this life? Do you want to have some place where you can live with for eternity, where there is no death, there's no sickness, there's no sorrow, there's no heartache, there's no tears, there's only life? Well, Jesus said, "I have come, I came into this world, me, Jesus, I came that you might have life." Eternal life only comes through Jesus Christ. And how does it come through Jesus Christ? Because he lived the life that you and I should have lived. Because all of us here have fallen short. We've not measured up. We've not lived perfect. But Jesus was God's perfect son. He not only lived the life that we should have lived, but he died the death that we should have died. For he died on a cross, but he didn't die for the sins that he committed. He died for the sins that we committed. And in his own body, he took God's judgment so that God could show us his mercy. God can't forgive you of your sin unless your sins are paid for. God is a just judge. He demands a payment for sin. Jesus died for your sins so that God could show you mercy. And they took Jesus down from the cross and they put him in a tomb. And 3 days later, what do we find out? We find out that death is conquered by life because Jesus, who died, rose from the dead. He said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." Folks, do you want to live for eternity with God? Who is the way? It's Jesus. But then he says, "I've come that you might have life more abundantly." Think about that. An abundant life. When you think of something this abundant, what do you think of? You think of a lot. You think of abundant food. You think of abundant wealth. You think of, the other day we were talking about the richest man in the world. You know who the richest man in the world is right now? His name is Elon Musk. You say, how much money does he have? More than he can spend. If you are able to spend, if you are able to spend all of the wealth of Elon Musk, you would have to spend $1 million a day, 365 days a year for 580 years. That's called abundance, right? Wouldn't you agree with me? I mean, he could at least tithe to us, right? That's called abundance. When Jesus fed 5,000 men plus women and children, most people believe it was at least 20,000 people. Do you know what he did it with? You know what he fed those people with? He fed them with five little loaves, five little biscuits, and two little fish. Five plus two equals seven. That's the number of perfection. And Jesus took that which was little, insignificant, I mean, just the lunch for a little boy, and he fed over 20,000 people with leftovers. That's called abundance. Jesus has said, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly in its fullness, in its riches. And that fullness of life is a life that changes. A life that once was filled with hate is now filled with love. A life that was once filled with lust and taking is now a life filled with giving. A life filled with misery is now filled with joy. A life that is filled with anxiety is now filled with peace. A life that is filled with harshness and bitterness and anger and resentment is now filled with gentleness. A life that is selfish and can't think of anybody else but itself is now a life of goodness that loves to give. A life that's out of control, like the maniac of Gadara, is now a life that is in control, clothed and in your right mind. Jesus has come that you might have life more abundantly. I want to share this story with you and I'll be done. A number of years ago, I was on a flight from Detroit, Michigan to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. I got bumped up to first class and I sat down in my seat. It was a window seat and a gentleman sat down next to me and he was a rather large man and I'm not a small man, so you know, we were rubbing shoulders together. And so we started talking, and I asked the man what he was doing, and he said he was flying to Philadelphia for a stem cell research conference. He had a PhD. He was from Los Angeles, California. He went to the University of Southern California. He had a PhD in microbiology. And he asked me, well, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm going to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania to speak in a Baptist pastors conference. And the words came out of his mouth immediately, oh, no. He said, why is it that I always get stuck flying next to people like you? I didn't want to say the feelings are mutual, but you know. And I decided that God put me in that seat next to that man because that man God's been working on, and I'm just going to be a tool in his hand because some sow and some water. But God gives the increase. And so I decided I was going to persecute the man with kindness. Man, I was as kind as I could be. And I asked him all kinds of questions. And man, he started talking. And the more he talked and the more wine he drank, the more he just loosened up. And then he turned to me and he asked me a question I've never been asked before. He said, have you found joy in your life? You know, go figure. Who asked you that kind of question? And I looked at him and I smiled as big as I could. I said, sir, I have found joy because I've lived on either side of the cross, before Jesus, after Jesus, before salvation, after salvation, without Christ in my life and with Christ in my life. And I said, sir, I can tell you that the whole of my Christian experience, and I'm not talking about that I don't have trials, please understand, but even in the midst of trials, we can have joy. I said, sir, I have experienced a joy that passes understanding. I said, I'm not just joyful when things are hard, but I've had the experience of an abundance of joy in my heart. I remember as a student in college reading my Bible early in the morning, and I would start laughing because what I was looking for in the world, I had just discovered in the Word. Because thy words were unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart, says the writer of Scripture. I said, yes, sir, I sure have. He said to me, he said, you know, the last time I experienced joy was 1984. He said, a fella's car broke down in Los Angeles on the side of the highway, and I pulled over and I helped him. And he said, that was the last time I had real joy. And so after a while, we talked more, and he said, you know what? He said, you're a pretty nice guy. He said, you seem like an intelligent person. I went, well, okay. And he said, now, you don't believe that the world was created in 6 literal days. And I went, absolutely. I said, because the Scripture says that God created the earth supernaturally, just like he made you and I. And that kind of ruffled his feathers a little bit. But then he came back and he thought, well, you're still a nice guy. And then he made this statement to me. He said, all right, go on. Now, remember, I haven't preached to him. I've just listened to him, asked him questions. He said, all right, go on, go on, go on. Tell me what you want to tell me. And I said, sir, here's what I'd like to tell you. I said, Jesus Christ died on a cross for your sins. And he was buried. And he rose again the third day, so that you could be forgiven of your sins and have the gift of eternal life. He said, oh, I know that. I said, well, sir, that's what I want to tell you. Folks, I want to tell you tonight, Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. You know why he did that? Because he loves you. He was buried just like anybody else is buried. And 3 days later, he walked out of the grave alive, conquering sin, conquering death. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. So I ask you, do you have life and do you have it more abundantly? If you died tonight, do you know you'd go to heaven? If you do not, then right now, from your heart, you can call out to God in humble repentance, God, I'm a sinner, and say, God, be merciful to me. I trust Jesus as my Savior, not myself, not a church, not my own self-efforts, but I trust Jesus tonight. Would you bow your head with me and close your eyes as we pray? Lord, I thank you tonight that you've brought all these dear people here for this concert. And Lord, if there's anyone here tonight that is without you, I pray that tonight that they would be saved. With our heads bowed and eyes closed, a couple of quick questions. Number one, how many of you would say tonight, preacher, I know that I have eternal life. I know I have it. I know that I've been saved. If I died tonight, I know for sure that I would go to heaven. Now, if you know that tonight and you know that for sure, would you lift your hand as a testimony to that? God bless you. You may put your hands down. Now, tonight, perhaps you didn't raise your hand, but you say, preacher, I do want life. And I'm going to tell you this right now. If you have the desire in your heart to want eternal life, that is from God. God's working in you. And you know what you need to do? Just like you open a door to invite somebody into your house, you need to open up your heart and ask Jesus to come into your life. I'm going to pray a prayer tonight. And I'm going to invite you, sir or ma'am, to pray this prayer with me. It's a simple prayer. And it's a prayer to be saved. And as I lead you through this prayer, you pray right where you're sitting as I pray out loud. Dear Jesus, would you please forgive me of all my sins? I am sorry for the way that I've lived. And I desire your forgiveness and your gift of eternal life. Thank you that you came that I might have life. and have it more abundantly. Jesus, I accept you tonight as my Savior. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Now, with our heads bowed and eyes closed, did you pray that prayer tonight, sir or ma'am? Well, if you did, then God's word is true. He promises that if you'll call on his name, you will be saved. And tonight, I'd like to welcome those of you tonight who've prayed that. Sincerely, I'd like to welcome you into the family of God, because this is how God saves all of us. So who would say tonight, preacher, I just want you to know, I did pray that prayer, and I meant what I prayed. If you did tonight, would you just slip your hand up right where you're seated? Preacher, I prayed that prayer. God bless you, you, and you. Yes, God bless you. Yes, God bless you. Thank you. You may put your hands down. Anyone else? Preacher, I meant what I prayed tonight. I asked the Lord to save me tonight. Anyone else? Would you lift your hand? Anyone else? Now, as we pray, I'm going to pray for those that have lifted their hands, and we give thanks to God for that. Pastor Kennedy will be here tonight after the service, and we'd love for you to just say a word to him. Say, Pastor, I did pray that prayer tonight, and I want you to know that I meant that, and I hope that you will tonight. Lord, I'm always amazed at the power of your word, but you have said that your word is what created the world, and that your son Jesus is the word. And thank you, Lord, that you've come that we might have life and that we might have it more abundantly. Thank you for the faithfulness of your word. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm going to ask the group to come back, and we're going to sing one more song. And as they come back tonight, we're going to do one more song, and then I'm going to let Pastor come to close everything out. Pastor Kennedy, thank you for letting us come tonight. I really, really appreciate it. It's been a blessing to be here. We've been looking forward to come to Delaware for some time, and we're so delighted to have been here. Out in the lobby of the church, we have a table that is a merchandise table. On that table, there are 8 books that I've written over the course of the last 10 years. I would highly encourage you, if you have any interest in studying the Word, I think you would be helped by any one of these books. They were written to be used for Sunday school classes, discipleship groups, small groups, home groups, or just personal study. And they cover subjects in the Scripture through various passages of Scripture. For example, this one is called Walking in the Spirit, Galatians 5. What does that mean? This one is entitled Encountering God, a study in the book of Psalms. And you study 10 Psalms and learn them. And the way you grow as a Christian is by growing in the Word. So stop by. We would love for you to take one of these prayer cards and pray for us. We believe that the reason why God blesses us is because God's people pray. Ask, and it shall be given unto you. So would you pray for us? On the back of it, if you have any interest in helping or supporting our ministry, it explains how that you can do that. This group is supported by the offerings of God's people. And so we have offerings that come in the churches that we're in, but also we have other people that give on the side to support our team and our ministry. And these are worthy people. Everywhere we go, by God's grace and God's mercy, we are seeing people come to Christ. And so please pray for us. One other thing, if you are interested in our recordings, a couple of things, you can stop by the table. There will be an iPad there. If you give us your email address, we will subscribe you into our email database, and we will send you emails and updates of what we're doing, where we're going, and also about our CD and how you can order it. You can order it online if you so desire at stevepettit.com. And so we would encourage you to do that, and then also to continue to pray for us as we're out traveling about. So you could do that. The CD will be released in April. We are having an online CD release concert. It's held in Greenville, South Carolina, April 16th at the White Oak Baptist Church, but it will be Facebooked Live. So you can watch it, and it'll be a great concert. And I think we'll have a great crowd there that night, but it's the night that we are releasing our CD to folks. So we're so glad that we've been able to be here tonight. We have one more service in Pennsylvania. We're over in the middle of the state in the town of Sealand Grove. You can find us online at stevepettit.com. We'll be there Sunday morning with a concert on Sunday night. I think we'll do, I think we're going to do, Kirsten, we want you to sing, Always Been Faithful. Can we do that one? All right. We're going to have, sorry about that, I'm switching this up. I want her to come and sing. This is a beautiful, touching song about God's faithfulness to us.
Amen. Aren't you thankful for the gift of music that God has given us? Let's give him a hand again. Thank you so much, Pettit team, for being with us. You've blessed our hearts. You've encouraged us. I'm going to dismiss you all at this time to your table in the back and give everybody that as they're leaving an opportunity to greet you guys and to talk to you. Thank you for joining us this evening. If you are visiting especially, thank you. We have enjoyed having you. We hope your hearts have been encouraged and blessed. Myself, Pastor Matt, and Pastor Tim will all be in the back. We have some coffee for you guys and some snacks. We encourage you to not just rush away. We'd love to get to meet you, and for all that are certainly home folks, stick around and fellowship with us and just enjoy some time together, especially for those that profess faith in Christ tonight. I would love a chance to get to talk with you in the back, and I try to look around a little bit for those that raise their hand for that, but catch me as you walk out, and we'd love to talk more about that and potentially get you plugged into a good church. That would be the right next move, and I encourage you all, in a couple weeks, we have our Easter Sunday program. And we would love to have you join us for that. There will be a special music program along with a lot of readings and then, of course, a time in the Word. And we would be honored to have you join us for that. The Pettit team travels really by donation, and they're funded that way. There's different avenues that the Lord has given them, but one of them is the gifts of people from the concerts that they put on. We do not charge anything, and I know that they are excited to be able to do that, but we would love to be a blessing to this team and show our appreciation and thanks for the time that they have given and how they have blessed. So we're going to have a love offering here as we are dismissing. In the back, there is a box. And if the Lord leads you, we would encourage you to, whatever he leads, to put money in the back there for them and be a blessing to the team. All right, I think that's all the announcements I have. We're going to go ahead and close in prayer, thank the Lord for the night, and then we'll dismiss to some coffee. It is decaf, by the way, so for the hardcore drinkers out there, sorry about that. But we do have some decaf coffee back there for you, and look forward to meeting you in the back. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the joy of the music tonight. Lord, my heart was encouraged and blessed. And I praise you for the gifts that you have given each of those that were performing tonight, and the voice and the string instruments and just all that you have blessed us with. God, we give you the glory for it. And thank you for those that put their faith and the trust in you tonight, Father. What a wonderful, amazing step, Lord, for them in their faith and their walk with you. And I pray that you would continue to encourage them, Lord. Give an opportunity to connect and to grow them as you see fit, Father. We thank you for the time that we have. Thank you for the food and for the fellowship. We pray that you bless that as well. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you all are dismissed. We will meet y'all in the back. Be sure to stop by the table in the lobby, the Pettit table, and I know they would love to get a chance to talk to you as well. You are dismissed.